Thank you, Nandan, for setting the tone for an optimistic future to look forward to. There's lots happening, and the sports ecosystem is really the place to be. Ladies and gentlemen, we've now arrived, as Nandan just said, at a stage of our evening which promises to be engrossing, given the participants and the topic. We'll now be inviting on stage a panel comprising of a few of our authors to discuss critical points and tracing various areas where Indian sport has seen a transformation. I'd like to invite on stage once again Mr. Abhinav Bindra. His sporting credentials need no further introduction, but he continues to give back to sport in various forms. Ms. Sharda, senior editor, ESPNcricinfo, and one of India's most reputed voices in sports media. Mr. Joy Bhattacharjya, CEO of the Professional Volleyball League and industry veteran. Ms. Deepthi Bopaiah, executive director, GoSports Foundation, also a former tennis and basketball player herself. And to moderate this discussion, I'd like to invite back up on stage managing trustee of the GoSports Foundation, Mr. Nandan Kamath.
Probably need one.
Yeah.
But thank you everyone for joining us. I think we just want to go through, it's going to be a quick and but a wide-ranging discussion on where we are in sport and what lies ahead. But first, if I may just start with a personal question of, we talk about transformation, that aha moment where you know we have closer to hope than to despair. Do you have an example from each of your lives in sport and dealing with sport where you felt there was a tangible shift from that notion of despair to the notion of hope of what is possible in India? Maybe Abhinav, if you can get started.
I think I have a little story to tell. I think it happened in a shooting trial, which was which happened in the year 2010 or 2000. No, it was after my gold medal at the Olympic Games, and you know, it was the selection trials being held in New Delhi, and I went there to shoot. And besides me was a 13-year-old boy who was competing, and he came up to me and said, "I know you, but I'm going to beat you." So I think that, to me, was the biggest change that occurred. I beat him, though, and I taught him that.
I've been a sort of fan of Indian sport through my entire life. And so, you know, I won't talk about cricket because that was another time that that happens. I won't. But obviously, I think watching Rajivardhan Rathod win silver and then watching Abhinav win the gold in Athens and in Beijing. You know, silver was fantastic because we'd always had. But I think the gold just described, it's like everyone went crazy. And I remember sitting there, you can wake me up at 3 o'clock and say, "Describe to me what that was like," and I'll be able to tell you. I have such clear memory, and I remember thinking that, what is this news going to, you know, what's going to happen in India? It was a Monday morning when it had happened, and I said, "How is India going to respond to this?" And you could, one of my young colleagues, Mohit Shah in ESPN, he said he was in school at the time, and suddenly they all got called to assembly in the morning, and they said India has won its first gold medal in the Beijing Olympics. And I remember, he said, "I remember that all of us came and we thought, that's it, it's a holiday, we can go now." So, but it wasn't a holiday. They all, it's literally like the principal and the teachers and everyone was there and they were all beaming. It would have been great to have been in India to see what that moment was like, but it was pretty good to be in Beijing at the time.
Joy?
No, I'll take a moment, much more recent. It was the under 17 football World Cup that we were doing, and for us one of the big things was, you know, FIFA, the way they operate, I told you, they had an 85 page manual on ball boys and ball girls, what they should wear, what they should not wear. So they were completely anal, and they expect that level of, you know, delivery from you. And here we are trying to do a tournament in India where things, if sportsmen in India, it's being tough being a sportsman in India, it's mainly because the officials we have had are not normally reputed, or, I mean, they don't set the stage on fire, let's put it that way. So here's the situation. FIFA is in India, and we've told them that Guwahati is this fantastic city where it doesn't rain, and it starts pouring for a semi-final. So we have a situation where in 48 hours, we have to turn around and we have to make a alternative arrangement, and FIFA is saying, no, cancel the match, do a toss of the coin. I said, if I go and tell that Brazil's going to have a toss of the coin to go to the semifinals, I will get slaughtered in Calcutta. So we decided to move the match to Calcutta on 40 hours notice. And FIFA turned around and said, we cannot take responsibility. And that was that one time that every official who we've been, state government official who've been fighting with for tickets, for this, for that, some magical moment they all got together, okay? And in 40 flat hours, we moved a semi-final match from Guwahati to Calcutta. And we were wondering, would we be able to actually fill the stadium? Because the point is that, you know, what's the point of having an empty stadium?
Yeah.
And so from, it was an 8 o'clock match, and I remember from about 5 o'clock onwards, they said, okay, 15,000, 20,000, 25,000. And that was the match we got the highest number of people. It showed me only one thing. The fact that all these officials, all the people that you see, if the cause is big enough, if somehow you can get them together, they can done do it. And that for me was a transformative moment. So from then I know that, okay, we're just lazy about it. We can really do it if we want to.
Capable but lazy, is that the...
So for me, actually, it was at the Rio Paralympics. And the moment happened when India won the gold. And just hearing our national anthem play over there and all the Brazilians stand up and seeing our athletes there, I think for me that moment just showed that, because just about 3 weeks before that, we were all complaining how we had just 2 medals and our women got those medals for us and nobody was worried about the Paralympics. And we're very fortunate the team at GoSports was actually had created profiles, were there, and to see that actually happen and then get chased by all the media people after that, I think was amazing. And today amongst us, we also have Varun Bhati, who is a high jumper and a bronze medalist at the Rio Paralympics as well. I think the moment really was the inclusion aspect of it. And it's sport at the highest level. It doesn't have to be only one way, but it's about women, it's about disability, it's about inclusion, and I think that moment was special and will always remain.
The Abhinav Bindra medal moment was special because I said, I knew it. I knew that an Indian athlete could win gold. I knew for the last, I had been working for about 20 years. I said, I knew that this was going to happen. So it was like a reward for all my mehnat and my belief.
And you knew it too.
Right? I can confirm that, and that, you know, it had happened in 2004 when I walked out of my final quite disappointed and with my world falling apart. It's you who, well, you were the one few people who told me that, oh, you'll win a gold medal the next time. It did happen. Somehow.
Sharda, tell me something.
But just at a broader level, I think a lot of your comments are around elite sport. It's medals, big events. Do we conflate sport and elite sport without really looking at sport in its full potential? Are medals important in this mix? Have we inverted the pyramid in a way that we should actually be focusing on other things as well?
I think so. I think, yes, it is important to win medals, but I think sport goes beyond that. And I think, you know, as I think sport can be used as sport has great power. And I think it should become really a social activity. You know, we have a young demographic in our country, and it should really be used to nurture talent and nurture the youth in a certain way. It'll help our youth become sporting. It'll help our youth learn to win, learn to lose.
Yeah.
And I think that is something so important in today's day and age. So I think beyond the medals, I think sport really has to be used as a sporting, as a social activity, and a way to build society.
Sharda, if I may just pick up from what Abhinav talks about, the concept of losing and the narrative around losing. I think for the longest time, we had this very warlike narrative of crashes out, and some of that is changing. But are we being a little too nice about losing, and should that concept of losing at sport be totally fine? And if you talk about losing, you talk about it factually. In many ways, sport has that value to neutrally allow you to lose in a non-judgmental way. Have we fully used the ability to lose safely in sport?
I think absolutely not, because the sports media is not built around that. You know, the sports media is like sports movies. They are built around happy endings and music and, you know, you win at the end of it. I mean, it is an unhealthy kind of a way to interpret an event that happens. But it's very difficult as a journalist, particularly if you're working on a deadline, as all newspaper reporters will tell you or website people will tell you. You're working on a deadline, you have to write fast. You have to say he played rubbish or whatever it was. You know, this is how they lost, this is how they won. That is sort of simplified. I think what there needs to be when you're assessing defeat or looking at defeat as to what it means. I'll just digress here and tell you something that happened after India lost the semi-final in the World Cup cricket. One of my friends, when I just came back here, and she said, did you see Virat Kohli's press conference? I said, yeah. He looked like he didn't care that he'd lost. Why? What is this professionalism that has come to him interpreting his defeat? And I never thought of it that way. I said, okay, he gave a reasoned and a rational reply. And I think often it reflects how sports fans feel, which is maybe you need to be able to make that distance. But I don't know whether the audience is ready for that kind of neutrality or distance to happen in case of, say, losing, in case of defeat. How do you look at it? I think what's happening with the hockey team, for example, defeat for them has become something that it's like a burden that they're carrying. And you can't, it's like there's too much emotion involved in it for you to be detached about it anymore. I remember when for Abhinav's last shot in Rio, all of us were like weeping. There was no way we could be logical about what had happened. You know, we were like, oh God, and whatever. And at some point, you also feel that it's like it's the fates have conspired against an Indian athlete or whatever. This is, people of my generation certainly think so. Milkha Singh by this much, P.T. Usha by that much, by this much. So for my generation, an Indian winning something at an international level is so unexpected and so fantastic that losing then the other way, you know, we've always written about defeat. So we feel really good to be able to write about victory in a way that is better. I mean, and that has changed in the last 10 years. I hear people laughing. I'm not saying that our athletes are... That has changed considerably in the last 10 years. Then you can't become triumphalistic. And that, of course, is the other side of it.
Because I think it was extremely moving to read the journalism around Kane Williamson and the World Cup, right? So just the ability to graciously accept a verdict, which very few other people would have accepted. I think there's social lessons we're perhaps not taking adequately from sport. And is your feeling that sports media has a chance for a rethink, should be looking at building that sports message? And I recognize sports media is about sort of talking about the news and what's happened. But is there a role for shaping India? And does the sports media ever consider the broader potential of what sport can do for the country?
As a sports journalist and a part of the community, I think you certainly realize that you should present sport in another way to people. You should be able to write about it and tell them things that everything's not about, you know, the people right at the top. It's the people at the bottom who make the people at the top. So that aspect has to be there. But I don't know whether we are still ready to handle this victory and defeat thing, because we haven't had enough volume of victories. I mean, I remember... I went for a conference in New Zealand once, and I was trying to see how many medals had New Zealand won in the Olympics. And it was 72 at the time. This was about maybe 10, 12 years ago. And you think 72 medals. So obviously you can be philosophical about defeat if you've had a lot of victories. Mm. But if you're trying and trying and trying and trying and you're getting that close and you're not able to... maybe as journalists you should be more neutral, but it's very tough to be. Maybe a younger journalist will be able to say something differently about it. You know, maybe it'll be a little bit more dispassionate. And I think the Kane Williamson story is terrific because apparently he was, he was being sort of joking a little bit on the morning after. And he was asked, he said, you know, that how can you take this so calmly? How are you being so calm and you're making jokes? And so he said, yeah, it's happened and you can't help it. And at the end of it, he said, sorry about the jokes, that, you know, sorry, I'm not taking this as seriously as you think I should. And I think Indians were more worked up about this. And our biggest, actually, that's true, the nightmare of every single journalist is that imagine if India would have been in the position of New Zealand. It would have been wretched. it would have gone on for days.
No, UN Security Council, sure. I mean, there's nothing below that that we would even imagine. That bat, that this thing, rules would have been examined. Bat, five gurus would have said that in that bat was special. Ichhadari Nagin ne kuch kiya tha bat ko. All that shit would have happened.
Which actually segues right into my next question, Joy. Is Indian sport being driven by what the viewer wants to watch? Leagues, packaging. Is what is playing worth, what is worth watching, worth playing today? Is there an intrinsic value in recognizing what is worth playing for its own sake? Have we been driven by viewership, TV ratings, what is broadcast rights worthy? Are we being thoughtful of what we're capable of and a capabilities-driven approach? Or are we really being driven significantly by what people want to watch and engage with?
Short answer is no. We are just, there is no philosophy to this at all. Somebody in 2008, we had a successful tournament called the IPL, which created this format called a league, which was wildly successful. And what has resulted as a result of that is that everyone has said that, okay, leagues, private leagues are the only way to do it. And there are leagues that, you know, they're very difficult to define. So, for example, individual sports don't lend themselves to league that easily. I'll give you an example. In the 1970s, there was something called World Team Tennis in the US. Jimmy Connors used to play for New York. John McEnroe used to play for LA. But when people went to see a match, they were watching Connors versus McEnroe because it's an intensely personal thing. Borg versus Connors versus McEnroe. The whole concept of a sport like tennis is gladiatorial. Now, if you try and put a league around that and say, okay, McEnroe plays one game, somebody else, it doesn't work that well. So the truth of it is, but on the other hand, the IPL is a successful model. When I go to advertisers, when I go to television channels and sell them, I have to sell them a league because the league is what works. So the sad, bad fact of the matter is that, yes, it is being driven by that. I'll give you another very good example. And I have, I mean, Hima Das is one of your athletes, and I think she's doing a wonderful job. But four of the five races that she won over that 1 week and that magical 15 days were races which she would have won in her sleep. And, you know, they were not up against the kind of opposition. Now, I'm looking at it, and at one level, I'm really happy that Hima Das is getting the attention. At another level, I'm telling myself, that's not why she needs to get the attention. In fact, Mohammed Anas at the same time has qualified, and her times were not good enough to qualify. So my point was not at all. It's got nothing to do with Hima. I think she's doing an amazing job. But some sports managers saying that if she does not win gold five times in a week, she's not going to be retweeted by Barkha Dutt and the Prime Minister of India and everybody. And that's what's going to get, you know, followers, supporters, everybody. Now that's the problem. The problem is, if you're in a situation where you need that kind of temporary fame, it's not good enough for a Satyan to say, I'm in the top 25 in the world, which is, I think, a fabulous achievement in table tennis. But you need to have somebody turn around and say, no, he's got five gold medals. It doesn't matter the kind of opposition you're going against. And that is a bit worrying because I said, we need to have. And why is it like that? It's because even the top journalists who are not from sport in this part of the country say that, okay, five gold medals, wow. Man, she's Jesse Owens, man. She's not. Not yet. You know? She's the wrong sex anyway. But, you know, there are a lot of other problems. But yeah, that's my point. That you have a situation where that judgment. So everyone is saying, today, the average sports manager is not saying, can she be on the headlines of the distinct sports page? They're saying, what is she going to do that's going to get her picture in Bombay Times? It's no longer the Bombay Times of India sports page. It's a Bombay Times that they want to be in because that's where the contracts come from.
Deepthi,
to add to that, I mean, I have a slightly other version of how we as a nation actually celebrated. If you look at Deepa Karmakar, right? We're working with her for the last 4 years, and we remember that she reached Rio. And when we were talking to her, she's like, "I don't have a personal physio." And she's like, "Huh? Yahan pe, you know, they don't think I'm going to make it to the final." And then she makes it to the final, and then she finishes fourth. And then the celebration that happened as a country, we celebrated the fourth place for the first time. So
maybe
why,
the second time.
PT Usha as well. Yeah. But, you know, in a sport like gymnastics, where we've never really, nobody thought she's even going to make it to the finals. And, you know, but the history of the state in that sense, and Sharda did a beautiful article about, you know, that region and how gymnastics is popular. But I think we are changing, we are moving, but yes, in terms of the media not probably saying it for the right reasons and we're not putting it in the right platforms, I think that's where the real disconnect is happening.
And incidentally, someone else also came forth.
And I'm far better finish than for my actual gold medal. I was actually on a discussion and it was being moderated by a journalist and he talked about my fourth place finish for at least half an hour. And I said, I did also manage to win a gold medal a few years ago.
But how much changed, Abhinav? So I think there's from 2008, we were delighted with that medal. But how did you feel the nation responded to your gold? I think you talk about the athletes and the change in perception. But were you surprised? What was your response to the response in some sense?
Well, I could not personally identify the hero that everybody else saw in myself. So it's tough for me personally. But I can understand why that reaction happened. I mean, it was something that had not happened ever in the country. And, at that time, I could not really appreciate it that much. But now, looking back, I have huge respect for, the admiration. And I have a lot of gratitude for the admiration that I received. And people took notice of myself, but not just of myself, but also of my sport. And I think those were the positives that came out of it. And I think it brought Olympic sport into people's minds and hearts. And I think more than anything else, it had that trickling effect also on athletes, on young people who wanted to start playing sport and started to wanting to get involved in Olympic sport and wanting to win. I think there was a change in aspiration. I mean, athletes want to win gold medals. Whatever the level of competition that maybe we leave it to that.
I think the Olympics are okay.
But they wanted to win. They want to go out there and win. And in earlier times, just going out there and participating was good enough. And now there's a huge, huge change. And I think there's a whole change in the way people think about sport and look at sport. And I think that's good.
Sharda, I think I saw you wrote yesterday on how many medals we're going to win at Rio, and I think the lid is off at Tokyo in a year's time. The lid is off, and one of the people you hope is going to win a medal is here. I think Bhavani Devi, our fencer. And I think you end your article saying, "Wouldn't it be fantastic? The fact that we can even dream of this possible in 2008."
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I mean, I remember seeing the Deepa video for the first time on YouTube and I said, this is an Indian girl. Okay, this is Commonwealth Games, all right. But this is an Indian girl doing this insane vault. Of course, nobody knew what Prodi Nova was like. Wikipedia, then you have to like manage backup, checkup. I had no idea that there was anything in Indian gymnastics. I knew that Ashish Kumar had won the medal in this. Delhi. I said, who is this girl? And I think even when I heard about Bhavani's story, it was like, what? Fencing? Why? From where? Why would you want to? So I think the entire sort of approach of what all our athletes can do and how much talent there is and how actually harnessing it in the correct way is where how big it can actually be and how much it can flourish and flower. And at that point, of course, Indians were always very envious of Chinese. Chinese medals came like by bucketfuls. When Abhinav won the gold, the Chinese silver medal, the guy who won the silver, he was crying because he had won silver. The guy. So, and all the Chinese reporters are talking to him nonstop in Mandarin and all that. He was like sobbing and, very bad because he had failed and whatever. And there's a Finn who won the bronze who was just sitting back and saying, what is wrong with these Asian people? First, there's this Indian and the Indians are weeping in the press conference. Then there's the Chinese guy who's himself. It was crazy. So, I think what Abhinav's medal certainly did was sort of unlock all this thing that was there. Unlock, maybe it just was coincidence that it happened at that time that you suddenly had these athletes in various and differing sports. And I've always maintained that, look, Indians are of all body types. The Indian population is not made up of only people of a particular size or whatever the physiology. We are of all body types. We should be very good at all sports. All Olympic sports if we tried, but it's the whole thing of the talent that is there. Then what do you do? Then there's a sort of a block that comes in the way, which is another favorite topic of mine, but okay, not now. So It is that what has been the big change of the variety of sports that are there and the success in badminton. Because I remember growing up when Prakash Padukone was at his peak, and I remember watching badminton matches on black and white TV and seeing how crazy it was. Places were full, and the crowds used to come to watch these matches. It was on live television. We saw badminton on live television, and to see that literally come alive again. And I heard about Saina Nehwal many years before anyone else had heard about, say, oh, this is the next girl. She's going to be it. She's going to be the new one. So it literally then became like a tsunami of people that came one after the other after that.
Interesting. And Joy, I think you're a fantastic chronicler of stories, and in particular sports stories. I think anyone who doesn't follow Joy on social media, you please follow Joy. I think it's both entertaining, inspiring, and so much more. But how much, Joy, have you seen the response now to our sporting heritage and past, the response more active, more engaged with things that have happened in the past? How are people responding? Do you feel like there's a greater appreciation of the journey we have traveled and the challenges that were faced in the past, where perhaps that context and in that time we were unable to appreciate?
I think definitely. And I think social media is fantastic for that, because, you know, social media is a kind of thing where, you know, 5 years, say, assuming, you know, 20 years back before social media came, the internet came, you said, you know, people who loved goats and you wanted a community who loved goats, you know, you wouldn't find a community. Today, if you said people...
By goats, you mean goats, greatest
as
of all.
As in goat.
Greatest of all.
I mean the animal at this point, but yeah. But today, if you type people who like societies who like goats, you'll say, whether it's long-haired goats, short-haired goats, angora goats. So what that means is that that particular kid sitting out there who just happens to like shooting now has a place to go and find somebody who likes shooting and read about it and read about Bindra and read about everybody and go there. So what the biggest opportunity that India has is that India has a phenomenally long tail.
Yeah.
So if you look at the number of people who actually, you know, why is, say, hockey... Today, even today, the World Hockey Federation is desperate to get India to do well. Why? Because, okay, India, hockey and I might have now become the fourth sport in India. But the fourth sport in India is worth 200 million people. You know, that's what we are talking about. So our tail is not just long. It's a fat tail. It's a crocodile's tail out there. And in every sport we have. So if there are just 0.1% of Indians interested in shooting, that's 1.1% of 1.3 billion people. We are talking about a serious number. So to any number, if we can properly focus on any number, we get people. And how do you get people? You get people by history. When you talk about it, what do the Brits do best of all? Go and see, there's a Lord Honours Board, 5 wickets at Lord, century at Lords. You go out there and, you know, the standard joke is Sunil Gavaskar is not on the list, Ajit Agarkar is there, you know, which Ajit never allows any of Gavaskar or Sachin to forget. But the point of it is, once I create tradition, you know, this is what Bindra did. You know, this is a story of what he did. Some 11-year-old sitting in, you know, Tuticorin will read that and said, I want to be Bindra. And today the internet, the kind of media that we have, allows that kid to have that opportunity. And I think that's very, very empowering. Take any sport in India, put it out there, especially on social media, and sooner or later you'll find out there are enough people. Because of our sheer size and diversity, we have the ability to present those numbers. So what sport really in India needs is people who can inspire these guys and say, come, this is my story. Come and watch Abhinav. Hear the story. This is what I want to do. At 11, I want to be a shooter. That's when the real results are going to come from. And I think that journey has started. He broke that glass ceiling. And I think there's no looking back from here.
And I think perfect marketing pitch for Go the Book. But Deepthi, I think you've seen an interesting journey, 10 years of Go Sports. We've seen it together. Perhaps at the beginning, people just a little bit cynical of abilities. How much has changed? How much has the belief system changed among people who support you, as well as the athletes that you support? What is the shift that you've seen, and how would you sort of encapsulate them with perhaps a story or two? Or
so I think we've definitely come a long way in the last decade. I remember in 2012, so we have a process where we do interviews with our athletes at the final stage of actually bringing them on board. And we were actually choosing our badminton athletes, and we had a great cohort of them at that point of time. And We had Kidambi Srikanth, a very young boy at that point of time, 338 in the world, sitting there and saying that, you know, so one of the questions we asked is, so what, how did you get into badminton? And he was like, when Gopi sir won the All England Championship, he came to Guntur in an open-top bus. And I saw that and I said, I also want to play badminton and I also want to become the best player in the world. But the way he said it, there was some sort of a belief that he can do this. And he was, you know, we selected him. And then the journey from 338 to world number one has just been fascinating for us at GoSports as an Indian, for the association, for every single person. So I think that really stands out for us in terms of belief system. And I think from the donor side and from people supporting us, I think initially it was a lot of friends and family who continue to support us and who are here this evening as well. But I think the biggest change that happened and the best thing that happened to sport for us, at least for foundations like us, was the corporate social responsibility, the act where they, you know, allowed 2% of the profits to actually come into sport and for Olympic and Paralympic sport. And I think Abhinav played a big role in that aspect, because it was just sport initially. There was no demarcation to what type of sport. It would have also included cricket at that point of time. But I think since 2015, the fact that we've seen the belief system of corporates believe that this is nation building through sport. They believe that this is not only about medals, but this is about the whole aspect of putting in a professional system, and maybe not 2020, but 2024, 2028. I'm sure we're going to see a lot of medals, and some of them are sitting here. So let's hope we, you know, see that.
One of the things that you will obviously, neither you nor Deepthi nor Aparna will talk about, is that the most significant thing to my mind that has happened in Indian sport, whether it was, again, coincidence, the perfect storm, whatever, is the creation of these non-profits that have come up, whose entire job is to basically make athletes, make a life of an either a junior athlete, as with GoSports and maybe Lakshya Foundation and the and Anglian Medal Trust and so on, is to make the life of athletes that are just coming through, or elite athletes, just to make their lives easier. I don't think there is any other country in the world that has created this strange new organization. And though I know the applause basically is because our other organization was so rubbish. That's why these people literally came up to fill this empty space. You know, why are these organizations here? I remember having a conversation with Geet Sethi, and he allowed me to quote him in it. And he said, listen, we would be happily become defunct if people did their jobs the way they were supposed to do. But those jobs were not being done. And therefore, these organizations came in and said, listen, we'll be the people that will be, you know, we'll be your buffers between you and finance, between you and, I mean, finance or permissions from federations or funds from government. So the creation of these buffers that then gave all of us as journalists these stories that came out of nowhere. How would we have heard of Bhavani's story or Swapna's story or Deepa's story? I remember meeting Deepa first at a GoSport, and I said, you are Deepa, you are the girl in the vault. And she said, yes. And she was just excited to be there. And it was an event where she was not the star. She was just there, and her coach was looking at her and said, don't eat sweet, don't eat this, don't eat that. That's what was going on. This was much before Rio. I think this was maybe have been 2014, 2015, something like that. And so the creation of these bodies has been literally, I don't think it's a fluke. I don't think it's destiny. I think it happened because it was a demand and supply thing, that the supply chain had got blocked. So these people came and said, we're going to clear the supply chain out.
I just want to add to that. I mean, that's exactly, you know, you look at SAI and working with most of these bodies. They are just, look, how does government decide anything? They decide your importance. Government department's importance is decided by how much money they control. Okay. Defense spends more in half a day than sports spends the entire year. It's because sports is, but for whatever reason, it is what it is. So what happened in sport, and I take it as an analogy to something which we have all talked about. That India, people said India would never grow because communications is vital. And India's at that time penetration was 4 landlines per 1,000 people. Okay, what did we do? We didn't get a landline back. So we couldn't make it 100 landlines. It's probably still at 40 landlines. We got a 956 phones, yeah. Mobile phones per 1,000 people. So my sense is that it's almost the private leagues. And the private leagues are also important, because what happens is, one of the crucial ways in which people in sport, say a state authority, controls a player is saying, I will select you or not select you. Nobody else will know. Today, if a player is good enough, he goes, walks across to another state, does a trial in, you know, Calcutta is not picking him, he'll go to an RCB camp, get picked up there, and then his local state has to recognize him.
Yeah.
So this, the private bodies, non-for-profits, guys like you, you guys are basically the mobile phones of sport in India. Because the government is not going to do its job. And we have tried, Abhinav has banged his head against the government. And the fact that he's got so much done is amazing, given how difficult it is to move the ministries. But depending on them is impossible. It has to be initiatives like yours, private leagues. Those have to be our mobile phones, basically.
I just want to add that in the last 4 or 5 years, we've actually seen the government also collaborate with us, whether it is the top scheme or whether it is, you know, the Khelo India project. I think there have been conversations at least that have started, and there is some interaction that is happening. So I feel to some extent there's conversation. So the next step would be to move forward.
And this is slightly dicey topic, but I'll just go ahead with it. That the Sports Authority of India is often cursed, and it's often you know, given all kinds of bad names and everything. But I, thanks to ESPN.in, I've traveled to many parts of the country, and you see that their centers are everywhere. They are everywhere in every corner. Literally at the far end of the country, there will be a Sports Authority of India center doing some sport, taekwondo or whatever it is. And so one of the officials in Guwahati Center, actually, he said to me, he said, listen, we can keep churning out these athletes. You don't have a problem churning out the athletes. We've got a lovely field at Paltan Bazaar, that crazy space in the middle of Guwahati in Paltan Bazaar, which is like basically like being in Chikpet, basically. In that the kind of area, they have got this huge football field, this huge indoor hall and absolutely outstanding facilities. The football field was training ground for the Under-17 World Cup. And the officer there said, the person in charge of it said, listen, we can create these athletes, but you have to give them events to play in. They have to have tournaments. They have to have a calendar. They have to have a structure. We can keep sending out one pole vaulter and one long jumper and whoever, but they have to have something to compete in. And now it's the fact that there are leagues, at least for some sports, absolutely, there are leagues there. That has helped.
I think this comes through very clearly in, for example, a sport like tennis. The example is in Spain, you have to travel 20 miles to the closest event every week. In India, you probably have to travel to another country. So in many ways, it's more expensive to be an Indian athlete than being an athlete in Europe. And it sounds counterintuitive, but is the case. But I think we tend to always, in this discussion of sport and transformation and change, it's always someone else's fault. Now, each one of us can also take responsibility. And I think there's... Sorry?
I know whose fault.
You know whose fault it is. So what we've held on to very strongly over time is this strong belief that we aren't good at sport. Now, we have lots of counterfactual proof that is actually false, right? It's a false narrative that we fell into. Is there a strong likelihood of overcompensating at this point? So feeling the guilt of having held a view that is actually not based on fact. We heard this view that we don't have a culture of sport, we don't even have the genes to play sport, and now suddenly we do. And in many of those situations, do we risk overdoing it at this point? And I think you gave an example of just celebrating Hima Das, where any medal is now celebrated. But how does the average person, one, participate, and two, I know scientific temper is a common term, but how do we build sporting temper in the average Indian?
I think what's happening classically now, what you're seeing is overcompensation. What is it? We are all, I at least belong to the generation where, you know, you have sports is something to do between sitting for entrance examinations. I mean, that's basically what you have to do. Get in, qualify. You can't do that, at worst become, you know, whatever it is, get a job. Okay. Sport was a side. And, you know, a lot of people even now still play sport because they can get a government job because of it. But what's happened as a result from that is from there, we have a situation now where these parents, this is of course, strictly upper middle class India, is saying, I want to have my kid, get the kid a chance to do lots of other things. And therefore, they're saying, go play tennis, go do this, go do that, we'll sponsor you. Because my sporting dream could never be fulfilled in that generation. You have that opportunity. The only thing is that, therefore, we are compensating in a way. We want sporting excellence in a way. The only problem is that, you know, it comes step by step. And I feel instead of, say, sending, say that, okay, I'm going to send my son to Germany for training in football, I'd rather have, instead of one parent spend 40 lakhs to do that, I'd rather have 100 parents saying, we are going to go and watch the school match on this Sunday, because if the coach is not picking the right players, at least if it's being played in front of 20 parents, they will know that this guy is good and this guy is not good, and they can't do it. That's where we need participation from parents. We need less parents who spend a hell of a lot of money to send their kids to a tennis thing. Less of those and more of them would just actively be involved in sport. Because I'll tell you the truth of the matter. The sports teacher in a lot of schools, and I don't talk about the 10-week and other schools, is the lowest of the low. You know, there's principal, then there's mathematics teacher, then some of the science teachers, then English teachers. Baki this thing. So sports teacher is general dog's body. Wo yahan bhi kaam karwata hai, principal ka beti ko scooter mein drop kar deta hai. This is standard. I'm not joking. I dealt with 20,000 student schools in Mission 11 Million. I've seen this. Now that guy is the lowest of the low. So when one parent even doesn't even need to give him money, gives him patta and said, "Arey, Anil saab, mera beta thoda sa, ab dekhiye na, thoda help kijiye." That kid will get selected. It doesn't matter if he's good or not good. The fact of the matter is, why is he getting selected? Because only one parent is coming even and showing interest. If 30 parents came and showed interest at that level, saying that, okay, this kid is here, let's watch the game, okay, no, we need to be involved. If we get involved in as a community in sport, we'd be doing sport a much bigger favor. And I think that's our problem. We don't do the small day-to-day things well. We do the grand gestures better. We don't do the day-to-day. And that's my issue.
And I think this comes out very clearly in sports policy also. This bounty system for anyone who wins an Olympic medal or anything else, like 50 crores from a state which doesn't even have anything to do with that athlete. So I think there's a lot of thought process and coordination required on that front. But I think just in conclusion, I think we could go on and on. But one question for all of you, and then a closure question. The first one is, should we host the Olympics?
She wanted more events a few minutes ago. So if she wants them, she gets them.
And he gave legitimacy to the Olympics.
No, We're lazy. We can do the event according to Joy.
But seriously, how should we be thinking about this?
I think the Youth Olympics is a good opportunity. The Summer Games can think about later. But I think if we can get a Youth Olympics to India, I think it would be great, because it'll make sure that there is investment going into grassroots. There would be investment going into the youth. It's also more sustainable to do. The mandate of the IOC is that you don't need to build new infrastructure. You can't build new infrastructure. The games have to be urban. You have to use public spaces. You have to use existing infrastructure. So in that way, I think it's more doable. And the fact that investment will go to the grassroots, which is badly needed, I think could be a step in the right direction.
Before Sharda, Joy, I think you have direct experience on something like this, the under 17 FIFA World Cup versus hosting a World Cup.
No, I think we're not ready. I think the youth tournaments are fantastic for India, exactly for the same reasons. I think that much of... See, India is a very interesting thing. Of all the countries in the world with 20,000 plus stadiums, 20,000 plus seater stadiums, India's fourth. There's the US, there's China, not surprising. There's Japan, because Japan plays a lot of baseball and other sport as well. And then there's India. The problem in Indian sport is not of facilities. It's of maintenance, actually. We just do not. We make these white elephants. I mean, huge ground in say, Nagpur, which will host one test match in 3 years. Ahmedabad. New. 1 lakh stadium in Ahmedabad, which will be very good for political rallies. But, I mean, of course, many places are good for political rallies. But to leave that aside, I feel, again, World Cup is a Youth Olympics is a perfect size of an event we should be taking. As a nation of the baby steps we are taking forward, I think Youth Olympics falls into this thing. I think if we go and overreach, a very good case is Montreal. Montreal is still paying off the debts from 1976 because they did not manage to get their books right. Great case study. When the country is ready, look at England. England in 2012 turned a profit. Montreal from 76 has still not managed to make up the money that they lost. And that's what you need. So if as a nation, you've got to be smart about it. It can't just be it's got to be events like the Youth Olympics, which actually give you some sort of a grassroots boost.
I'm not a fan of hosting mega events in India, because I don't think, that there is any merit in doing it, because it comes and it goes and it's done. What happened to, in 2010, we won 100 medals. in the Commonwealth Games and the Asian Games. Combined total 100 medals. It was fantastic. And and literally we studied how much money went into each medal, and it was about 96 lakhs per medal or whatever. That's what it takes to win medals at that level. And then England's cost at for London 2012 was a multi-million, crazy amount. Because once that event is over, then what happens? You know, so Ashish Kumar won you the gymnastics medal. And then what happened? And of course, Deepa was there and she came out and she produced this performance. And now what's happened? The Gymnastics Federation is still fighting. Why are you wasting money on something which is basically, it's like it's just icing. There's no cake, you know? So I'm not a fan of these big events in that. Even the World Cup, Women's World Cup that's going to come in. It'll be fun. It'll be great to report on. It'll be great to cover. We'll get fantastic stories. Are you still going to sort out your football league or no by then? You know, that is what is important. That is what you have to do. And see, doing these events to me just appears to be like, let's have a party, you know, and then you have a party. You know, it's like that. It's a party. And I understand what if I saw, you know, at the under 17, they set up great training grounds and they really spruced up those facilities and they're fantastic. And hopefully they're still being maintained well. But I don't see the after effects of those translating through at the level, never mind grassroots, local level, and even sort of say state or district level. I don't see the translation. That requires hard work. That requires sustained work through the year, which you don't see happening. So what is the point of just having a party? Just to feel good about yourself or whatever, you know?
And it's done very transactionally rather than as a relationship between a country and that sport, right?
Absolutely. I mean, I don't think they even think about it in that way. I don't think it's even thought about in that way.
Also, just to add to that, Montreal was the only Olympics where the host didn't win a single gold medal, you know. So remember, you have a situation exactly like that. So they created an event, and I'm saying that, you know, as a sporting nation also, maybe we should look at it when we say that, okay, we have 20, 25 medal prospects, we are there as a nation, we have done that road, you know, we have gone up that ladder, we've reached a certain level, then we should aspire to a senior Olympics.
Yeah, I completely actually agree with Abhinav saying that we're only probably ready to host the Youth Olympics. But yeah, how do we use the facilities after they're created? And I think one of the constant discussions we have, you know, with the athletes we have the opportunity to work with is most of them are actually traveling outside of India, even for their basic events, just to see if their training is working well. They have to go and check their timing at an international event. So if we can have more national level events across the sports and more people watching that and, you know, participating in that, I think in 2-3 years, we'll be ready to then host something because people will be aware of the ecosystem of talent that's available. And we don't need to spend that kind of money to send them abroad to actually see whether the training they're going through is good enough or not. So it's a combination of what I think everyone said.
Great, excellent. And just on that note, closure statement from each of you, a story, a message, anything for our audience today that you would like to leave them with.
Well, good luck to everybody. no, but I think you talked briefly about how everybody can contribute to sport. And I think you always don't need to sign a check to be able to contribute to the development of Indian sport. You can just go out there and watch sport. And, you know, I competed in India for 20 odd years. I never had a spectator watching me in this country. And then I had to go and shoot an Olympic final with 10,000 people watching me. So it was overwhelming, and I'm still bearing the after effects of it. So just go out there and watch. I mean, you talked a lot about Deepa Karmakar. How many of you have ever heard of her? How many of you have gone and seen her? So if there's a next district competition in your vicinity, if there's a state meet, and even if you don't have much to do with sport, but just go out there and watch. You'll be contributing to the development of athletes.
My message is, you know, just to athletes, because I just find our athletes really unbelievably optimistic and positive people. I'm just astonished that no matter what has happened that's bad, that is against them, that's adversarial, despite all the best efforts of everyone around them, they keep pushing ahead. They get up every day and they go for training and they practice and they just push ahead. I'm just so sort of humbled and I'm so moved every time I meet an athlete like that. Whatever their intention may be, eventually, sport in India, I know that everyone has spoken about sort of the urban setup. I still think that sport in India is a livelihood for people. It still is a livelihood for the majority of the country. We are not 55 trillion or whatever nonsense that we keep hearing. We are not even close. I mean, and our athletes they come from the poorest of families, the least resourced families, and they still push ahead. And I'm just so grateful to them for doing that, you know, because they are carrying urban, you know, they are carrying our urban anxiety and our self-doubt and what they're carrying it for us, you know, and they do it all the time and they do it, you know, so hats off to them. And like you said, all good luck.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I look at it and this is perfectly anecdotally, but I think there is a change. I mean, in the building where I stay in Gurgaon, you know, 10 years back, there'd be about two people walking in the morning, maybe one person running. Today in the morning, you go down there, you'll see 30 people walking, briskly walking, about 15, 20 people running, the gym people lining up. The interest in health, recreational sport and health is something that we cannot ignore. It is happening because it's your next stage as a nation. You know, you've done roti, kapda, makan. You're now looking at what's beyond. You know, your hierarchy of needs has increased. So another simple example in IIM, I've been giving guest lectures in IIM Cal for the last 6 years. And there were 28 people the first year that course was offered. Now, there are 150 people. They've had two sections. And still, because there is an over number of students enrolling in it, and they're not allowed to, they have a system in which they have to sort of apply with points to make sure that they get into the course.
Is it on sports management?
Just on sports management, entertainment sports management. And regularly, of the 175 people per class that you take, there are 100 people sitting out there because there are 25 other people who couldn't get into this class who want to be there. So everyone there is pushing you to, you know, they want to get involved in sport. People think now that sport is something worth doing. What is just holding us back is a creaky old infrastructure of state which is sort of trying to adjust, trying to manage. If somehow we can break these bounds, and we are breaking them day by day, as I'm hearing, we have an opportunity. I think this is our time. Our time has come and it can no longer be stopped.
I think just two very short stories of, again, two very lovely athletes. Bhavani Devi, we've kept hearing about her. And again, she comes from, she's from Chennai, and she actually took up fencing because in her government school, she had to take up some sport, otherwise she would be punished. And she decided that this sport doesn't have too much of movement, so let me just go into this class. And from there, she started. And Bhavani Devi, 3 weeks ago, was the first Indian to make it to the World Championships round of 16. If all goes well, she will be the first fencer in India to qualify. And we, because of working with her, we've actually had the opportunity to work with another 8 young junior fencers. She currently is training in Italy because we don't have the coach set up over here. So 9 months of the year, she is in Italy. She's learned the language. She's placed herself there. And, you know, they need all the support. So it's just one person who can make it, and we'll see a whole bunch of youngsters actually taking up that route. And sitting right next to her is our very own city's Chikarangappa, the golfer. Again, was a caddy, and you know, was a young boy thinking, what is this sport that everyone's playing? Actually broke a tree branch, started using that as the club, and then today he's one of the best golfers in India. Again, attempting to qualify for Tokyo, and we wish you the very best.
Thank you, Deepthi. I have the privilege of the last word, and I think we had a book launch today. Many might ask, what is the power of a book? And I'd like to tell the story of one of our athletes, a young girl called Avani Lakhera, who's a Paralympic shooter. Her journey in shooting began by reading one book. It is Abhinav Bindra's autobiography. So she was in an accident, recovering from that accident, and wanted some belief. She read Abhinav Bindra's book, and in 2 years, qualified for the Tokyo Paralympic
she's
Games.
She's got her Paralympic berth as well, yeah. She just won the medal at the...
She's 17
years old.
So the power of a book and the power of a story But that story is no ordinary story. So I think just more than anything, just a huge round of applause for Abhinav. What you have done is amazing. You may not believe. I think he's a serial underplayer of his own story, which is why many of us have to tell it. But this has been a wonderful evening. Thank you so much for joining us. I think we'll have Aparna to conclude. But thank you so much, my panelists.
I will conclude in a minute, but I'll also hold you all back on stage for just a moment longer. We do have tokens of appreciation for everyone on stage. And to give away these tokens, who better than the two athletes we just heard about? Bhavani Devi, Chikka Rangappa. Could we have you up here on stage, please, with us? Also, Varun Bhati, Paralympic bronze medalist from the Rio Paralympics. Could you all please join us up here on stage to thank our panelists for this evening? Thank you. Could we just get a photo of everyone on stage together, please?